deadliest school shooting since Sandy Hook. On Valentine's Day yesterday in Florida, it took place. It's 5:30 a.m. and the news has been on since I've been home. Since 1 o'clock in the morning, I've been waking up every hour or so, looking at the CNN TV glow. Came home, opened my email, my friend Kevin asked, how are you processing this? That I was in the studio getting ready to sing, and the drummer walked in and said, hey, did you see this? I said, what? He said, looks like another high school shooting. I said, where? He said, looks like it happened about an hour north of Miami. I said, how many? He said, looks like 14 or something. I told Kevin from that point on, my band discussed it for maybe 20 minutes. Donnie said, why don't they just get rid of the guns like they did in Australia? And I sat there befuddled and said, I don't know what to tell you. But the Republicans like having their right to bear arms. Blows kids off the planet, they spend the rest of their lives without their legs and arms. The Republicans believe in their right to bear arms. No matter the rising death toll and the amount of harm it causes to innocent people, they have the right to bear arms. And honestly, from that point on, we picked up our instruments. I got three musicians out here from New York, and we're here to play music, and we're on the clock. So until I got home tonight and saw your email, all the thoughts about the Florida shooting I blocked. Another player had joined us last night around 6 or 7. We were improvising on a piece of music that he said sort of reminded him of Bill Evans. It sounded good to me. It sounded like a slice of heaven. Jim was playing his drums, but Donnie wouldn't play. And after about 15 minutes of this beautiful piano playing, Donnie stood up and said, you guys, this doesn't sound like Bill Evans. I said, what do you mean? He said, this is Bill Evans. I asked the drummer, did you know this? He said yes, and I said, well, what in the fuck are we doing? I said to the player who had joined us, man, for 15 solid minutes, I was like, damn, this piece of music is genius. And he said, well, like I said, it's this left-handed thing and the style of the 11. I said, but Donnie and Jim said, it actually is Bill Evans. Thank God they were here to tell me this. Thank heavens. Or I would have released this beautiful song and someone would have called me out and said, you ripped off Bill Evans. I asked the guys, who is this guy anyhow? It's Bill Evans. They said, one of the most famous jazz pianists in the world. I said, I think I may have heard it. Or maybe I'm getting him confused with the chain food restaurant, Bob Evans. Bob Evans, yeah, I got bad associations with Bob Evans. I was with my friend's sister Debbie when I was 18 in Ohio at a local thrash metal show. We walked outside to have a cigarette, it was freezing outside and the ground was covered in snow. When a girl confronted Debbie outside and said, you're so fucking cool with your nose in the air, don't you? Debbie said, what are you even talking about? I've never even met you. The girl said, you're a fucking snob. I've been standing around and observing you all night with your dyed black hair. You think you're too cool for school, don't you? Debbie got tense, raised her voice and said, so I've traveled a bit. What do you know about anything? What do you know? Debbie's tone was getting aggressive and escalating. She said to the girl, where in the fuck have you ever been this far besides Ohio? And the girl just stood there and got this big smirk on her face, and I thought, oh no. And she sucker punched Debbie, knocked her ass down on the ground and spit in her face and walked back to the thrash metal show. I lifted Debbie from the snow, and she stood there sobbing and sobbing. Her brother came up to me and said, Mark, what's going on? What happened to Debbie? I said, man, it all happened so fast. I'm sorry I didn't do anything to protect your sister. He pulled me aside. He said, let me tell you something, Mark. Don't worry about it. She's always had a mouth on her. I said, I know. But she's your sister. I've got her back. You enjoy the concert. I got it from here. I said, don't worry about this, Debbie. We'll shake it off. Now let's get the fuck out of here. We got in her car, and I told her I understood this humiliating feeling. Oh, I got knocked out a few times myself, and I know it's humbling and embarrassing. So we went to Bob Evans and sat and drank coffee, and I tried to talk Debbie into a calmer state. She was so distracted, and I tried to console her, but she was clearly hijacked and in too much emotional pain for conversation. Debbie dropped me off, and from that point on, I don't think I ever heard from her again. I think it's because she associates me with that bad night that ended at Bob Evans, and I understand. And on the way home, I said to my friend, why'd you kick off tonight with a Bill Evans song? I was just trying to ease into things. I said, that's cool, but we're not a cover band. We're here to make an album of original songs. He said, yeah, I guess that was wrong. I said, yeah, and then everything is sort of anticlimactic when you try to come up with fresh ideas after playing Bill Evans. He said, yeah, you're right. I don't know what I was thinking. I said, hey, don't worry about it. Everything else you played sounded amazing. Anyhow, I came home and I turned on the news. Angry as I always get when these things happen, trying to think of what I could do to help the cause, to influence people, to do what I can to change gone wrong. For starters, I'm gonna dedicate a song to the kids from Florida who didn't live long, whose families grieve while the rest of the world gets on their phone and their lives go on. Maybe in this song I'll share my own private thoughts. In fact, I think I will. I think they should go Django Unchained on the killer they caught. Hang him upside down and cut off his balls. Bleed him to death and let him bleed a slow, bloody death. When 17 kids are murdered, you skip due process. I don't care if he was born into a home full of drug abuse and incest. We're allegedly brainwashed by white supremacists, whatever the case may be for him. Yeah, it's very sad and unfortunate, but escorting this man from the planet isn't everyone's best interest. When a guy kills 17 kids, dispose of him quick and fast. I live in San Francisco, and my thoughts on this might go against the flow. But yeah, I think they should torture me to death, whatever the methods may have been used at Guantanamo. Make an example of him and hang him up to dry. I say more aggressive action should be taken against mass shooters, at least give it a try. Anyone who maps out the death of innocent kids should not have the privilege of being alive. Maybe the parents of the kids will get together and kill them vigilante style. Maybe somebody down in the local jail will meet up with him in the infirmary and stab him 17 times. And justice will prevail, and that'll be the end of the story, the Valentine's Day killer's miserable life. So I asked Kevin by email, by the way, how are you processing this? It's gotta be harder for you than it is for me. You got a 13-year-old kid. But Kevin's on New York time and it's 6:30 a.m. and so far from Kevin, no reply. Another day in a life. 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 Another day in the life. Another day in America. Another day in the life. Republicans will say this has been a sad day in America. We're sorry for the families of the dead children. Then they'll go on about Second Amendment rights and stand there with their white dicks in their white hands and stand next to their white wives. Another day in America, another bag of white rice. I just woke up this morning, February 15th. I had a dream about AR-15s, probably based on the news that said 8 million Americans owned AR-15s. And I dreamed I was doing vocals. I asked my engineer what kind of mic we're using today, and he said, an AR-15. I said, isn't that the name of the gun that did all the killing at the school yesterday? And he said, no, that was an M49. I said, I thought we normally use a U-47. He said, sometimes, and other times we use an Audio Technica 4060 or a Shure SM7. And I said, well, they all sound like a bunch of automatic weapons to me that send innocent little kids off to heaven. So I prefer if we don't use the AR-15. And he said, but it's the best microphone the studio has available. I said, but that microphone is what politicians use at press conferences. Then I woke up from the dream. So that's it. I got out of bed, I took a bath, got ready to go to the studio. And I got Kevin's reply by email. I called him up and asked him if he would kindly read it to me.
Reading and internalizing what's being written about it and tweeted about it, which is that nothing ever changes and another shooting will happen every 60 hours. That Columbine, which is 20 years ago now, was in the news at that time for months and years, but Parkland will likely disappear from the news cycle in a week. George Carlin used the expression circling the drain. Circling the drain to describe the human condition. I believe the hour, this ceaseless, endless madness and violence and the resulting information overload and the subsequent collective amnesia has to mean we're so close to the drain at this point. Circling it so intensely at this point that the experience can no longer be processed because it's moving too fast. Maybe because we're being processed, pulsed, like vegetables.